And now we get back to more like the origins of sports and physical activity. So we obviously took quite a ride to the virtual side of sports, which was apparently, at least according to your faces, a little bit like a new experience, which was good, apparently. Hopefully we can find some useful hints from the previous presentation of how can we solve the challenges of the future of the sports and sports marketing. But now we go back so that there is going to be a very clear challenge and a very clear assignment for you during and after this presentation. The next presentation will be given by Baptiste Colin, known as Eric Bana as well. I recognized that yesterday only, so there is a striking, you know, similarity in the looks of these guys. Baptiste is working for ISCA, as you can see, International Sport and Culture Association, headquarters located in Copenhagen in Denmark. And one of their missions is to promote physical activity so that we would move more. And apparently it is not the opposite mission than the e-sport people necessarily have, but this next presentation will give you really an opportunity to do something about the situation in Finland. So please warmly welcome our colleague and friend Baptiste Colin. Thank you.
Can everybody hear me? Yes. I'm sorry to say that I'm not Eric Bana. I'm not famous actor, but yes, I come from France. And today, at first, I didn't have a title for my presentation, but I made this one, and I want to make a comment that I've also been a student like you, studying sports management and also sports and social sciences. And semantics matters, so indeed sports, I understood it also as a, let's say, competition, organized and elite sports. But just to clarify that the organization I come from represents a network of sports federation, but more on a grassroots level, sometimes with competition, sometimes without competition. What we also call sport for all, in some of the terminology we use, and also somehow organizations that promote physical activity. And one of the terminology that we use is also the word move, and you will see in the programs and campaign that we use that word quite a lot. So my name is Baptiste Colin. I've come from France, as you can probably hear with my accent, and I live in Copenhagen because that's where I work as a finance and project manager for ISCA, International Sport and Culture Association. ISCA is an umbrella organization like the Finnish e-sport federation. We represent a network of sports federation mainly, but sometimes it can also be a university that we have as a partner. And we try to advocate for more sport and physical activity as tool to promote social change, health, and better societies, and also to, let's say, bring people together. Because as we are an international organization, our main also aim is to bring people from different cultures together. You also have sport federation at the national level. They are doing their job, and they probably do it better than us sometimes to promote on their level some of their activity. But as an umbrella organization, the idea is to make people connecting and exchange ideas and work together so we can have new ideas in each of the country. We also have Twitter. We are not always very modern, but we try to use social media. So if you want to mention, I don't know if it's on at the moment, but if you use Twitter anyway, you can always refer to our account. tagline of ISCA is moving people. So that's what we are trying to do and what we are trying to promote. This year is a special year for us because it's a 20 years anniversary. And last week we had our annual congress where we gathered a lot of participants from our members and other organizations. And it was also an important moment. But now, specifically to the topic I want to talk about today, it starts in 2010 when the European Commission published a study, what they call the Eurobarometer on sport and physical activity. And that's also where the scientific part comes. I didn't mention, but I'm not a scientist, I'm not a researcher, so I'm not gonna present very hardcore figures, but I'm more here presenting the actions that we are trying to implement so that we move people physically. But that was a study made by the European Union where you had some of the, how do you say, countries that were listed, and you see who is physically active on a regular basis and who is not active at all. And you can see that some of the countries are more, let's say, active than some others. Scandinavian countries usually are doing a better job than countries in Europe from the southern part. And well, again, you have data and you can try to analyze them. But what we try to do, when I say we, I was not there at that time because I already only arrived in 2011. But what ISCA tried to do is to send a political message out of this data. And how can we use, as organization, this data to promote our cause and to recruit more members in our sports club and association so that we can attract more people. And now we'll just show a video which is happening in the European Parliament. And this is the president of ISCA, who is still now president. And the interesting part is that our president Mons is trying to use a funny way to promote amongst politicians, because there it's mainly politicians, and institutions, how can we raise the topic on the agenda.
But increase of participation and especially making inactive
people sorry, I will get that.
Is a quite more complex process than visibility of sports stars and big events. So back to the vision, and I have to excuse me because I brought some assistance to illustrate a little bit, and that will be to honor the podium. I brought 5 teddy bears today to illustrate Europe. We have here 5 small teddy bears, and they are representing each 100 million Europeans. Today, we have 40% who are active, and we have 60% who are not so active. And this guy, he knows it's dangerous. He knows that physical inactivity is the 4th leading death cause. So I think our common goal is to exchange one of these inactive with another active, and that will give altogether 100 million more active in sport and physical activity. Thank you very much.
Now it should be better. So why I wanted to show you that is that because how to use the data and showcase it and somehow try to advocate for your own cause. And from that study became a let's say, political vision, which is kind of a goal, a name that ISCA is trying to pursue. But we know that this goal cannot be reached alone as ISCA, because it's a very, very ambitious goal, and it's quite hard to reach. It's to have, yes, out of 500 million citizens in Europe today, 200 millions are kind of active on a daily, weekly basis, and we want to bring that 100 million more, and that's the gap between actually the kind of average active countries, the 40%, to the 60%. And yes, we use the Baba Papa, those puppets, to kind of illustrate what we wanted to reach. And that became this vision, which is called the 100 million more European active in sport and physical activity by 2020. We will probably not be there, but that's nice to have this kind of mental goal in front of you to try to fight every day to engage more people in physical activity. And then, from this vision, which is just again a sentence and political will, how do you communicate that? How do you reach people? And here we come back to marketing fundamentals that were also presented at the first presentation. When we also talk about somehow customers, because if our aim is to move people, our customers should be the one that maybe are already moving, and we're gonna try to make them move even more, or the one that are not moving. And how do you do that? Well, that's not an easy one, but you can do it step by step, and for sure, like it was mentioned in the first presentation, you need to understand your customer, you need to respond to them, you need to engage them in a way, not only sending message on TV and say, hey, you have to do sport, and you have to do sport, but okay. Apart from that, how do you activate them, and also engaging them in some activities? And I will come back to that later, but there's also a point where we need somehow to measure our action, and that's why we ended up cooperating with Risto and Sports Business School Finland, and I'm happy, I want to thank for the invitation today to be able to speak, because we felt that we had to measure more our activities and to understand better who are we targeting and who are we working with. And from that vision, we moved to a campaign that we launched in 2012, which is called the Now We Move campaign, with this logo. And yes, the word move is present in a lot of the aspects that we are doing at the moment. Basically, the main message that we are trying to also share with this campaign is that sometimes it's not only about doing sports, but it's also about exercising and doing physical activity. If you do it with somebody else, there's a social aspect, so it's even better. And also, how can you have fun while you do physical activity? So then we kind of tried, sometimes successfully, sometimes not successfully. And if anybody has feedback on the things that we have been doing until now, I'm also very happy to hear them, because sometimes you have to start from zero and you make quite some mistakes along the way. So now I'm just going to present a video that has been developed to try to spread the message of our cause. Cut the mic.
We're born movers. We climb trees, race down the hall, and throw stones as far as we can. So how did moving become a burden? Well, we're told to sit still and listen, and slowly we stop. And then we wonder, why are we out of breath? Why do our backs hurt and our bellies grow? Move Week is your chance to change the tide by organizing a team, an event, or a race to help people find their move. Become a move agent and make your move at nowwemove.com.
So this was an example of what we try to promote for one of our elements of the campaign, which is called Move Week, and I will come back to that. So back to the vision, getting 100 million more Europeans physically active with some objective. Here we have three. It's about awareness. So raising the awareness of physical activity benefits and trying to engage people. Capacity, it's also about recruiting actors, because if you want to reach people on the street or in their house, you need to have some agents. Not only 10 people in Copenhagen are going to be able to do that on European level. So we have to find people that we're going to train and that are going to be helping us to do that. And also then, Move Week came as kind of a platform for engagement, when once a year, during 1 week, we will have a time dedicated to promotion of physical activity, and we will try to use it as a showroom, as a flagship event for our cause. And this is five elements that we have kind of developed within our organization. One is Move Week. Congress was last week, something what we call Move Awards, and the other ones are related more to a project that we do with our own members. They are not somehow directly reaching the participants or the end user. And this year we have come with more elements, whereas we have done a lot of activities. Flash Move, we have organized for the first time in June, what we call the No Elevator Day. So it's also trying to get incentive to people to forget about the elevator, but taking the stairs during 1 day, and more if they can. We're also trying to go to the European Parliament and try to convince MEP to raise the topic on the agenda. And a lot of different other things. We did a cross-border cycling tour that started in July and ended in September. And also PANA tour, which is PANA is kind of street football. So we have a lot of different activity. And what I'm going to just present here is what's called Move Week. And I'm going to present quickly the results of this year. Whereas Move Week is somehow open for everybody at first. Now we are also trying to kind of segment and give activities for specific target group, because if you have a global message which is broad, it's not easy to target very specific people and to make everybody joining your movement. But you can see the orange color, that's kind of the main color that we are using. And many events happened around Europe with younger people, kids, older people, people with disability. And in 2015, which is kind of the fourth edition, because we started in 2012, we have been able to engage 38 countries. I can tell you that Finland was one of it, but there is a but that I will come back later on. We had engaged approximately 1,700 cities, somehow small and sometimes big. A lot of volunteers, because we are somehow a volunteer-based organization, so we work with grassroots sport organization, and they are run mainly by volunteers. So without those people, we will not be able to run that event. Municipalities, also some government that have supported us. That came also, of course, time throughout the years to make our brand known and to reach these people. And at the end, we had around 1 week, 7,100 reported events. So that's people who reported events, and those people, they are called Move Agent. Move Agent can be an individual, it can be a local club, it can be a university, it can also be a national federation who is engaging. And at the end, this year, we somehow engaged 1.5. I don't know exactly of the number because some of the people that are content here are also somehow spectators, which most of the time were engaged in the physical activity when we had outdoor activities. But last year we had like 1 million after starting in 2012 with only 100,000. Then 13, we had 500,000 people around Europe. Then we became 2 million, and this year 1.5 somehow. And we are pretty happy about the numbers, but at the same time, 1 million is big, but it's also very small, because if you talk about 500 million citizens in Europe, it's not a big percentage that you have reached. But still, we are trying to, let's say, grow the movement and grow the numbers. And that's where I wanted to come back to, because in Finland we had one event. That's a start. And yeah, what I want to say is that, of course, the campaign we have developed relies mainly on partners. And now I'm glad that we have Sports Business School Finland as a partner to work with on some of the aspects. But in general, we have not had until now some partners that we engaged in Finland. But we would like to have more activities in the future in Finland. And sometimes activities are also organized by very active and young students. So that could be some of you. This I'm going to pass because this is the other events that we had, the Pana Tour, the No Elevators Day, and how many people we have engaged. Any kind of figures and any kind of information you want to have. We have a website which is called nowwemove.com, www.nowwemove.com. And there you have all the sub-websites with all the sub-events. People can very easily register and say that they will organize an event. And then we can enter into contact and sometimes give them materials, and they are getting stickers so that they can promote Non-Elevators Day in their office or in their sports club or in their city or something like this. That was the cross-border cycling event. There is also an initiative around schools. We also did quickly, if I have time, a flash mob. That was happening throughout Europe. One day at the same time, on the, I think, 13th of September this year. And what we are trying, and also that's one of the drivers of why people are engaging with us, is to give this European dimension. And when people know that one day, at the same time in Europe, people are gonna do the same activity, the same choreography, it can give, once in a while, this extra incentive. And that's what we are trying to promote somehow. So, in the end, we believe that this year was a success, yet there is still a lot to do. Now I go back to the question of how we did it. Because we started in 2012, where we gathered in Berlin 20 organizations, and we said, we want to do this European Week of Sport and Physical Activity, we want to organize it, and we want you to be the one that are going to relay. And over the years, we have, how do you say, gathered what we call national coordinators. And national coordinators, not all the time, they are like sports federation. But you have like Feridun, is from Turkey, and he's actually an engineer and a teacher. And because he's very active, he has engaged his whole campus and university into organizing events and physical activity. And yeah, that shows that sometimes you don't need to be the sports sector to be the one activating, but you can also not only work with others, but as a sports sector, it's also maybe important that we actually don't stay within our own borders, but we reach out to other sectors, and we also talk to other people that are not maybe the specialists. We as sports sector will provide maybe educators, the ones that are really knowing and have the know-how on how to engage people, but reaching other sectors so that you can engage more people into your events. And yeah, I can show another one, which is Tina, for instance. She was a volunteer in ISCA, and when she went back to Estonia, she was not working for any organization. She was just an individual. So we also have somehow individuals that just at one point said, I want to do something. I want to organize an activity with you. And they are the one that actually run the campaign. It's not me, neither people in our office that actually are doing everything. It's those people that are the one doing the thing. And yeah, then we have on the website, we have all the national coordinators from the countries, and we try also to market ourselves using LinkedIn and everything, so that not only there is a name, but there is a face behind who is organizing. And yes, this for us is very important, because if you have a vision of 100 million European active by 2020, if you are doing it alone with your own network, you're not gonna make it. You have to work with other organizations, and that's why we try to engage, for instance, a federation which is called the European Cyclist Federation. They are not the European branch of UCI, but they are just promoting sport as tourism, bicycling as a tourism, and also as a means of transportation, so that cities become more bike friendly. And we can also, of course, work with education, with universities, and we try to do that, for instance, with Sports Business School Finland, and a lot of other sector. And maybe the gaming is one where we actually have to learn a lot, because indeed, when you have old traditional federation that were created 100 years ago or something like this, it's very hard to create change. And sometimes you just need to look to the newcomers that are the ones that are actually grabbing the trend, and they are directly responding to the need of the society and also of the people. So why not trying some other cooperation? But we have not been able, of course, until now to work with everybody, but we try to gather and to learn from a lot of people. And our last helper is this mascot that we have created, because we wanted to give also, let's say, more transgender and iconic view of the movement. Now, what time is it? Okay. Now, I would like to do something. It will take not more than 5 minutes. Can I ask everybody to stand up, please? It's gonna become after, I will tell you. Actually, I didn't mention that I will do that, but it's gonna take only 5 minutes, not even 5 minutes. Everybody knows the game rock, paper, scissor. Well, what we're gonna do is that you're gonna pair two and two, and you're gonna play that for five round, and the one that gets the most point out of it, so normally three maximum, will be the winner. And I have brought some bracelets. Unfortunately, I don't have enough. So the winner will have the chance to get a bracelet at the end. So please enjoy for a few minutes and have fun. And in 2 minutes, we go back.
5 times?
Yeah.
All right.
Everybody's finished. Now you can sit down. It's gonna come right. Yeah, it's gonna come right after.
Yeah. Just let me know.
Yeah. Okay, thank you for that. Some people will ask, why did I do that? For a very simple reason, I'm not very good in actually doing those kind of games. I have some of my colleagues that are very good, but what we try to do sometimes in ISCA when we have a conference and what we talk for the whole day about, we have to get people more active, you have to get, you know, people moving and blah, blah, and suddenly you spend the full day sitting and not being active. And I think it's important, whether you have meetings in the future or conference or whatever activities that you have, that sometimes it's also nice to stand up, activate people, even if it's for 2 minutes doing an energizer, and it helps you to believe even more in the cause that you are trying to promote. So that's sometimes things that we do. And last week we had like a flash move during the event where people were dancing. Of course, it's a little bit hard to organize a football match or these kind of things because then people are going to sweat, they're going to want to shower and everything. But sometimes a little bit of activity for 2 minutes, if it's fun, can be interesting. So I presented somehow what has been until now the past of the organization I'm working for. And now that we talk about also the future of sports marketing, I want to ask that question, are you prepared for the future? And this is kind of a question that our president has been sending as a message to all the members, because even though we are not elite sport, even though there is no big sponsorship around the activities that are promoted, even though maybe in terms of numbers or viewers, we are not on TV where you have millions of people viewing our activity, somehow the organization we work with, they still have some issue and things to solve, where those are kind of the questions that are sent to our members and partners, which is like, what is the value of your brand? Even if you are a local sports club, what is the value that you are carrying and carrying with you? Because if you are able to really define who you are and what you represent, maybe you're going to be able actually to market better what you are doing and to attract more people. And I think some of the federations that we are working with have, not that they forgot that, but they did not always think about this. So yes, they do nice activities with nice values, and they want to do activities for a good cause, but sometimes it's not enough. You also need to brand yourself, you need to be good in communication, you need to be good in marketing, and that's somehow something which is very important. Second question, are you innovative enough? Are you able to change your own organization so that you can adapt to the 21st century and being in 2015 where people are maybe not engaging into sport as they were before? Maybe people don't want to be in a setup, they just to be out in the street, and how do you catch those people? Also, how do you work with the growing elderly population, and how do you actually give them activities that are suitable for them, because not everybody can play football until 50 or 60, so how do you answer those questions? One is also about good governance, because it's not because you are not part of the elite sport and that you don't have FIFA or some other organization that have issues with corruption or good governance that you don't have also your own problem. Even in the local and national federation of, I don't know, pétanque, if anybody knows the practice in France, maybe you can also have corruption there. So it's also very important that grassroots actors are also trying to take care of this aspect. Fourth question, is your political influence sufficient? Are you having enough political influence? It can be towards EU, it can be towards national government, but it can also be towards local governments, and you need to advocate for your cause. You need to reach the politicians or other institutions to make them understand that what you are doing is important and that you do it also for good reasons, and that maybe also at the end they can also give you some more money, because we all need that at a certain point. What does the media talk about it, about you? For our campaign, we have worked with national coordinators where they are reaching the media, but this year, for instance, it was a little bit tricky because at the same time that we had our Move Week, we were part of what's called now the European Week of Sport, which is organized by the European Commission. And it's kind of basically the same than what we have been doing in the past. But now the Commission wants to take action on that. And then it creates a lot of problem in terms of communication, because suddenly the media, the newspapers, they don't understand. It's like, okay, but we had Move Week in the past, and now you are talking about European Week of Sport, but it's happening at the same time. So that was this year's issue, and maybe then we need to work on that. But it's also important to have a clear message and to make sure that media are talking about you, even though if you are a local sports club, that's important. And trying to understand what, on the long-term perspective, what makes you relevant as an organization, that you will still exist in 10 years, because society will evolve and people will have different needs, so that's important. And to do a better job as ISCA, we actually came across Sports Business School Finland because my boss, I think, met Risto, and then we kind of started to talk. And we saw value in actually working with your school, so that we try to understand how can we do a better job. And to do so, because we have this architecture where we have ISCA, then we have the national coordinators, and then we have Move agents, and then we have the participants that are organizing the event throughout Europe. But we don't always communicate directly with the participant or with the Move agents, and it's not easy because we are a small organization back in Copenhagen. So how do you know who are the people that are actually under your umbrella? Who are the ones that are doing the activities during Move Week? And for that, we didn't have really the right tools, so that's why we started to work with Sports Business School Finland to kind of develop some sports business intelligence and to do some survey that we've been running until now. One is a survey for Move Week participants, and we asked many questions, and then last year we had kind of 1,000 of respondents. This year a little bit less, but we are still analyzing the results. Asking questions of, you know, satisfaction and a lot of other questions. We also did kind of a survey for Move agents because they are different people and they also have different needs. So again, you need to understand who those people are, what do they want, how can you serve them so that they are doing a good job and they want to engage not only for this year but next year and maybe the year to come. And how can they, I would say, integrate your brand and really feel associated to it so that they will keep engaging with you and be happy about representing your brand? This was one of the questions. And we also did this brand and value survey where we are trying to understand how people are, how to say, understanding us. When we talk about Now We Move, what does it represent? Some of the findings, not surprisingly, that it's about healthy, about international, and about fun. And the fun aspect is also something we're trying to work in a more sharper way, because we believe that actually somehow people are gathering and doing those activities also because they are having fun. And we have not, I think, explored yet the full potential of that, but that's something we want to work on. And why we need to do better is because in Europe and in our modern society, there is a big problem at the moment, because in general people are not as active as maybe they were, or they are not enough active, and that has a cost. And this is also something that we try to work with other organizations, where we are trying to use numbers so that we can actually, on an economical level, measure how much does it cost to the society the fact that people are not active in terms of social care or in terms of any other aspect. And that's what we try to do with this what we call inactivity time bomb, where we did a survey, a kind of study with an organization based in London, and that kind of estimated that the cost for Europe every year was somehow 80 billions. And now, well, it's not my level, but it's a level of the president or the people that are more on the political level. How do you use that figure to convince politicians, the society, that somebody has to take an action to make people more active? And yeah, I was talking about this before. This European Week of Sport, organized by the European Commission, is just to say that there is kind of a raise in awareness that we need to tackle this issue. And even the big institutions like the European Commission are trying to tackle this a little bit more. So there is money invested, either it's public money, but it might also be sponsorship, and that's something we have not been very good until now to reach. But there might be, you know, insurance company that would be also interested to work on this topic, because for them there might also be a business case, whereas people that are more healthy will cost them less money than people who have disease or this kind of thing. And last thing I want to show is that sometimes it also takes some creative ideas or tools to kind of get that point where people are actually willing to stand up and to do an activity. And this video is, to me, a very interesting one, because it's targeting only female. It was not done by us, it was done by Sport England. But to me, it tells me a lot of where our sector has to go if you want to reach more people, and if you want to make them understand that doing physical activity is maybe not that a bad thing, and it's not that hard, and that you can all do it. Of, at least to my opinion, a good campaign that actually went quite viral on social media, at least in England, because it was based in England. But yeah, sometimes if you have the right message, and if you have also the right resources to create such a video in the right angle, it can also help to reach your cause. I'm almost done, but now I would like to make a little workshop where I'm gonna ask for your contribution. The reason why I'm doing this is because we, even though we have been able to have good numbers in terms of the number of people that we have been reaching, we kind of also realized through the studies that we are making that most of the people that we are reaching are the active one already. Because it's very easy to engage somebody who is very active, somebody who is like a volunteer already and, you know, sports and wants to do stuff. But how do you reach the ones that are not active? And that's some of the questions that actually I don't have an answer. I wish I would have, but because otherwise we will get even bigger and maybe we get more money and these kind of things. But so first, I have a challenge for the students mainly, because I want that we make Finland moving during Move Week next year. We don't know yet when it's going to be, but I count on you. And I think we can do it. The second thing is that's where there's going to be two things. Either papers that are going to be circulating, and then you can be two. So one piece of paper per two. Either you also can use the hashtag of the day, whereas then that will allow me to collect your contribution and maybe use that as generating ideas for the future of our campaign. The first task is to write on this piece of paper one to three ideas that you might have of activities that you could organize eventually during Move Week in 2016, or any event that you would like to do to promote sport and physical activity and to reach people that are not active. B, one to three innovative ideas on how to reach the inactive. I don't expect that somebody is going to find the golden rule and that we are all going to be satisfied at the end that we have the answer. But sometimes it takes just a group of people to think about, okay, what can we do? And how can we find solutions? And maybe in one of the papers that you're going to hand at the end, that's going to be the answer. And the last point is that if you are interested to know more about our activities, please write your email address on the paper and then I can contact you at a later on stage. At the end, I will try to make sure that the papers reach this side of the room and that they go down and that I collect them. And then we can go for some final questions. So now just take 5 minutes to write either on social media, on the paper, those things, and then we can just have a few questions and then we finish.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Baptiste. We are letting you people to do a work for a few minutes. And please use the modern technology as well so that you can show Johan as well that we are not only, you know, very active physically, but our thumbs are still up and you know, working.
It does not need to be very complicated. It can be just a few words or a sentence, because just something that pops up your mind.
As said, when you're answering the question, please take into consideration that in this room there are people who are able to really enlist to ISCA as Move agents. And because of this seminar, we are able to increase the number of Finnish Move agents by several hundreds of percent, if you so decide. And we would like to encourage you to do so, because you can do it, as the small person in the picture stated. Okay, so that we can stick to the original timetable, I'm asking you now to start handing out the papers first to this side of the rows and then to the front. And all those who really will change the current situation of Moorwijk in Finland, please step forward with your contact information and do the job. And about the program, we're going to have a short Q&A with Baptiste here. He apparently did a good job replicating Q&A by getting the best of you, some ideas and good feedback. We will prepare the next presentation right after this, so we don't have a break right between these next two speakers, because the next speaker will start just a few minutes right after we wrap up this one. But if there are any questions right now that you would like to ask, please raise your hands and we deliver a mic for you.
Hi, thanks a lot for the presentation. Just maybe because of my job as well, I'm wondering about whether you've explored the idea of working with international federations or the IOC for that matter.
We have not traditionally been working much with the IOC, International Olympic Committee. There are also other actors in the sportful sector, like TAFISA or other actors that we've been trying to work together with, and some of them are the same sometimes activities or challenges. But we have some of the national coordinators or move agents who are working with Olympic federations at the national level, and we are completely fine with that, because the more you can reach people, whether it's Olympic sports or non-Olympic sports, it's fine. But for sure, I believe that we have not explored enough those partnerships with those organizations. Maybe because we are not from the same network and we sometimes maybe not meet all the time, but and we're also not having so much money or resources, human resources in Copenhagen to go out throughout Europe and meet those people. But I believe that, again, when we say about cross-sector collaboration, it's about being open to everybody. And it's not about like something that we try to do with Now We Move, and maybe it has positive or negative impacts, that we don't try to put ISCA at the front, but more the brand Now We Move, so that other actors, they can join and they don't see it like, oh, this is ISCA and it's not us and we cannot take part of it. We want other actors to be part of this. And I mean, there is Now We Move, but there is other activities. And as long as everybody find its kind of audience or customers, and that we different actors can reach more people, if it has a positive impact to the society, then it's good. Our president used to say there is enough inactive people so that we don't need to fight against each other. If you want to get more members, don't try to steal the ones that are, because that's what's happening sometimes, is that Football Federation is trying to reach more people, but then it's like less in other federation, but sometimes you also need to reach to the ones that are not active, because there is a big, in terms of business terms, market share to reach more people. And some, yes, will be maybe against any kind of sport or physical activity, and so be it. But there is still a lot of potential to reach a lot of new people. So, yes, other actors, Olympic committee, yes.
Okay, any other questions you'd like to address here at this point? Okay, one question that I would like to make, Baptiste. I think the slapshot effect of people participating Move Week is almost as impressive as the figures that Johan stated about, you know, the the esports and its growth. What do you think if you would actually, if you would be able to pick some kind of a core type of an event? We have a colleague here, Billy, who arranged actually invented the idea of Pihapelipäivä, which is the sort of event that we spoke about. Do you have any like idea of what kind of an event would be some kind of optimal for your needs and requirements, or for your ideas, like the ideal? Is it an outdoor event? Is it an indoor event? Is it like team sports, or what are you looking for when you think about, you know, the optimal type of an event for Move Week?
Well, during Move Week, it's somehow everything, and that can also be a challenge, because if you are not specific enough, it can confuse people. But I will say that we are also looking for non-traditional activities, whereas outdoor sports are very important, and that's where sometimes you can bring a lot of people together. Because when I say we promote physical activity, it's not only exactly that, because that will be somehow shooting ourselves in the feet, because we represent sport for all organizations, and we believe that the social aspect is nice. So it's good that people go running on their own, but if we all do that and we don't actually spend time together doing physical activity, that's not as nice as if we can do it together and have fun. So usually during the Move Week, it's more about open doors. But what we try to promote is more like innovative activity, or like, I don't know, some new sports or some new physical activity game that can have the fun part and the social part, and that are sexy enough to attract people. And I think we've tried to kind of, at one point we had worked with an agency where they were kind of advising us to develop new concepts of sports. We didn't go that direction, but that could also have been an option. I don't know if it would have worked, but try to be innovative. And the one that are already doing for a lot of time their traditional activity, then they can keep on. Of course, it's not a problem. So it can be from traditional to non-traditional sport. It's not a problem.
So what I would suggest here is, if you have got any like new idea to promote, like new kind of sports, I'm not saying that, you know, this frisbee golf would be very new, or Nordic walking would be very new, but I think that these Move Week types of events that are European wide, they could be utilized also to promote something totally new and new types of sports. As Baptiste says, it's not about having a specific type of an event, it's just to make the people move a little bit. You have a question, so let's shortly take that so we can move on.
Just out of curiosity, have you thought to change the picture a bit, since you seem to have this problem of making active those older generations, that you would actually use the younger generations to activate the older ones and use the segments like fighters to activate dancers in that wise?
You mean in the communication tools that we use?
Yeah,
maybe my presentation was not representing enough what we've been doing, but if we try also in the tools that we use to have this transgender and also over the ages visual identity, where people can identify themselves. But probably there is more to do in terms of indeed cross-generation activities, where some people will activate some others. That's a good point, yeah. But we have not, you know, when I say we are trying to be innovative, I don't consider ourselves as the most innovative, because we would like to be more innovative, and that's why sometimes you can get good ideas from people.
There has been a good way of promoting elderly homes, making them work with kindergartens.
Yeah.
Okay, did you put that on the paper? Because, yeah. Okay, you should have done.
I will write
Please
it.
Do.
I
Please
will write it.
Give a new paper so that you can write it down. So that's the idea, actually, that we can refer to. I suggest at this point that we give a round of applause to Baptiste. Thank you, bro.
Thank you.
We're going to prepare the next presentation, so there is no break at this point, so we start immediately after, so please.
But stand up and move. Yeah. Now you have a few minutes to do that. So
excellent.